Thank you. Good morning and welcome to the third meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have one item on today's agenda, and that is to take evidence on the replacement of EU structural funds in Scotland from the Secretary of State for Levelling Up, Housing and Communities and Minister for Intergovernmental Relations, the Right Honourable Michael Gove MP, who is joining us online. And a very good morning to you. I welcome Secretary of State to the Finance and Public Administration Committee, and we have almost 90 minutes for this evidence session. Before I open up the discussion to members, I understand Mr Gove would like to make a short opening statement. Secretary of State.
Thank you very much, Convener. I first of all wanted to say it's a pleasure to appear before the committee again. On the last occasion on which I did so, I was able to join you in person, and so I apologise for joining you virtually, but I appreciate the work that you're doing scrutinising both the Scottish Government's budget, but also the relationship between the UK Government and Scottish Government is critically important, and I welcome the accountability and the chance to answer your questions and provide you and Scottish voters with more information about the UK Government's role in promoting levelling up. As the committee knows, the UK Government has a commitment to making sure that we can invest alongside and with devolved administrations in order to ensure that we can improve productivity and access to services, in order to ensure that every part of the United Kingdom enjoys the same opportunities for growth and flourishing. We have put in place a variety of different funds which operate across the United Kingdom. The Levelling Up Fund, perhaps most prominent of all, but also the UK Share Prosperity Fund, the Community Renewal Fund, the Community Ownership Fund and others, as well as establishing Levelling Up partnerships with individual parts of the United Kingdom, including four in Scotland. And on top of that, we've also invested in two investment zones and two green freeports. Both of those investments have been done in partnership with the Scottish Government. They've been co-designed with the Scottish Government. And the geographical spread, but also the enthusiasm shown by local government in Scotland and by business in Scotland, I think is testament to the power of two governments working together. And of course, while the UK government and the Scottish government have disagreements on issues, obviously, most prominently, the constitutional future of Scotland within the United Kingdom, I'm pleased to be able to say that there is pragmatic day-to-day working at every level with ministers and officials who remain committed to doing the very best for the people of Scotland.
Well, thank you very much for that opening statement. I'll kick off with a few questions and then I'll let colleagues in from around the table. I think one of the key issues, of course, about the whole levelling up agenda, and of course, when I say that, I talk about the other funds, funding streams that you mentioned, and I think colleagues will go into some of those in a bit more depth, is the actual volume of cash that's actually allocated. So yes. I'm just wondering how the money, not that's just been allocated, that has actually been spent in Scotland over the last 3 years compares, for example, to what it would have been if Scotland had remained in the European Union?
Well, again, I think that the amount that we've allocated, I think, has been allocated in a more responsive way than the way in which EU funds were allocated. But overall, we are committed to making sure that with the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, we match the funding that the EU would have given. We've still got a number of EU projects which are in their outworkings providing funding, but overall our manifesto commitment which we kept is to match the amount that the EU spent through the UK Shared Prosperity Fund and other funds. And I think I'd argue that things like green freeports and investment zones actually show a greater degree overall of investment from the UK government than would have been the case if it was left simply to the EU.
I mean, you talk about an increase in investment, but I'm not hearing any actual funds of what has actually been spent over the last 3 years. And the Institute of Fiscal Studies says that UK departmental budgets in the forthcoming financial year will actually be less than they were in 2010. Mm-hmm. That doesn't really help levelling up or that agenda, does it, surely?
Well, you're absolutely right that across the whole spending pattern, across the whole of the United Kingdom, we've had to take account of some of the significant inflationary pressures that are a result of global economic factors. However, it is the case that there's a real-term spending increase in public spending in our plans across the United Kingdom. And in terms of specifics, we are spending £52 million on green freeports, £160 million on investment zones. The levelling up projects, 24 levelling up fund projects that we have so far are worth £485 million. UK Share Prosperity Fund already committed is £212 million, and that will increase over the years to come. And then the Levelling Up Partnerships that we have is another £80 million, £140 million in addition for the long-term plan for towns. And that's on top, of course, of the money that's been committed in the past through city and growth deals, which amounts to about £1.5 billion. And there are some other smaller funds as well alongside that.
Yeah, there seems to be quite a plethora of funds, it has to be said, and it's trying to get a kind of grip on where they all are and how much is actually being spent on the ground as opposed to being allocated. But one area where there's no dispute in actual fact is that the amount of capital that's going to be available to the Scottish Government is going to reduce significantly over the next 5 years. By up to 20%, according to the Scottish Fiscal Commission. That Deputy First Minister said in real terms it's more likely to be 11%, but whichever of those figures you actually accept, that's how. Surely if capital budgets are declining, that kind of works against what you're trying to do in terms of levelling up, if capital budgets are declining at the same time. And we're talking much more in terms of capital reduction in Scotland than we are in terms of the money that's being spent in levelling up.
Well, I'd say two things there. I mean, the first thing is that overall, the amount that's given to the Scottish Government for the Scottish Government to spend through the block grant is at the highest level ever, £41 billion. And again, it's for the Scottish Government to decide, quite rightly, how it allocates that money amongst its various priorities. The other thing I'd say in terms of capital spending is that the whole of the UK benefits from the full expensing that was brought in at the budget, which allows investment in the private sector, capital investment in the private sector, in the productive economy, to be set against tax. And that, of course, is a big boost for industry, for jobs, and for investment as well. I should say that some of the capital investment that we've been looking at UK-wide is also contributing to that economic growth as well. And I think it's the case that only today there is renewed capital investment from Sumitomo in the Green Freeport in Cromarty. And that is an example of the Scottish Government and the UK Government working together to unlock capital investment that creates new green jobs from the private sector.
Yes, I mean, I think you're right. The resource budget has gone up by above inflation if we accept the GDP deflator at 1.7%. But even with that, capital allocation from the UK government is declining significantly. And that is really, I think, beyond dispute. And what you talked about initially, you talked about inflationary pressures. And I think that's a really important issue because, as you know, my own area, we were delighted in October 2021 to be awarded £23.7 million for the upgrade of the B714 in North Ayrshire. And I think that will make a significant difference to the North Ayrshire economy. And it was welcomed across the board, as you know, myself and the local MP both supported that, as did the local authority cross-party. But since then, what's happened is that inflationary pressures have hit that project hard. I mean, the cost has now increased by over £5 million. And when you came to this committee 2 years ago and I raised the issue of inflation going forward, you said that that would be a matter that would be considered in terms of these projects. Now, my understanding is that the local authority has been advised that they will not have an increase in the funding. Only about 10% has currently been spent so far. Because of all the kind of work that has to go in before such projects are started. And so they've effectively got a £5 million shortfall on that project. So surely if the United Kingdom government wants these projects to succeed, and I'm pretty sure it does, then in cases where the recipients of levelling up funding have absolutely no control over costings because of the construction inflation we're all well aware of, the UK government should, to ensure these projects are delivered as originally intended, step up to the plate in terms of providing the additional funds.
I think it's a very fair point. I'd say three things. The first thing is, obviously there's a responsibility on local partners to make sure that they apply appropriate discipline to any project. And when funding was allocated in the first place, there's always a little bit of wriggle room. But I do take your point that inflation has been high, coming down now, of course, from 11.1 to 4%. So that does help, but it is still a significant factor. The second thing is that local authorities can submit what we call a project adjustment request, which means that if they believe either that the scope of the project needs to be reduced or altered, or the time scale over which it's delivered extended, or if they feel that they need additional funding, that critical additional funding, in order to deliver a project, then these are all things that would be considered on a case-by-case basis.
Okay, and has that happened? Have you got any examples in Scotland of where that's actually happened so far?
I know there have been a number of project adjustment requests that have been made by some local authorities in England. I don't have a record of any project adjustment requests in Scotland.
Okay, I mean, it'd be helpful to know that, because obviously there are the real concerns that the local authorities then have to allocate money from other capital funds, which are under pressure already, to ensure that these levelling up projects are completed. Just to move on, there's an organisation here who've submitted some information to us. They're called SLADE, not to be confused with the 1970s pop group, I have to say. It's the Scottish Local Authority Economic Development Group. They have a number of issues they have raised with us. So, for example, in terms of how funding was allocated, they feel that they were concerned that there was no local authority that was successful in round one was successful in round two, and they said that, you know, they're concerned that this was a consequence of a UK government decision taken at a late stage in the process not to approve any bid submitted by a local authority that had been successful in round one. And they say this gave rise to doubts that the bids selected were not necessarily the best submitted in terms of quality. So I'm just wondering why the government decided to do that, because obviously some authorities are a lot bigger than others, Glasgow being an obvious one, and they had a number of projects they want to submit because Glasgow has a disproportionate number of deprived areas.
Yes, no, I absolutely appreciate that. I would say that the whole process of allocating funds has evolved over time and has changed, and we've taken on board some of the concerns that have been expressed by local authorities and also some of the welcome experience that some local authorities have shared with us about the effective working of the process. We have formula which seek to allocate the funds on an objective basis, and I think we've shared some of the details with the committee and I can share more today. The important thing, I think, is that if we look at spending in the round across all three rounds of the Levelling Up Fund, and we also look at the spending that's been allocated through Green Freeports, Investment Zones, Levelling Up Partnerships and elsewhere, we have a very good geographical spread across Scotland and a particular concentration on areas of greater deprivation. So we assess both the quality of the bid, the deliverability of the bid, but also the metrics which lead us to decide whether or not a particular area is important. It is the case that good bids have been funded, including a number of bids in Glasgow, and indeed in the Greater Glasgow Economic Area. Our long-term plan for towns involves long-term funding for Clydebank, Cambridge, Greenock, and these are all communities that we recognise have suffered as a result of economic and industrial decline in the past. They are being supported, as well as specific projects in Glasgow. And Glasgow, of course, is an investment zone and is receiving, as a result, some £80 million in order to support the work that's going on there. And there are smaller projects in Glasgow, including work going on to revive Drumchapel Town Centre, which are also, I think, evidence of our commitment to that broad geographical spread.
Yes, I mean, I think something like 21 of 32 Scottish local authorities have received awards through the three rounds. But one of the issues that came to us from Clackmannanshire, for example, which is one of the smallest local authorities, the smallest mainland local authority with about 50,000 people, is that they had real difficulties in terms of the time scales for actually submitting allocations, and so therefore they were unable to bid. But they say that because of the size of their local authority, you know, that the lack of capacity they have within that local authority in terms of their own staffing, because, you know, these kind of projects don't come up all the time. They don't necessarily have these officers sitting there hoping that they will. They're kind of disadvantaged. And I would also say, on that, with regard to other local authorities that have not received funding, some local authorities may seem prosperous on paper across the board. East Lothian is an obvious example. Much of East Lothian is very prosperous. But parts of East Lothian are not prosperous at all and include some of the most deprived areas of Scotland. And so they feel that the metrics that the UK government is using are not taking account of some of those kind of issues.
No, I think that's fair. So with Black Manager, again, as you say, I think it's the smallest local authority in Scotland, maybe East Renfrewshire or East Dumbartonshire, which are broadly similar in size. Yes, there are challenges there, but there are some also some other small local authorities, small in terms of population, but not size, like Dumfries and Galloway, that have been successful in putting in bids. And Dumfries and Galloway is, I would argue, in a way, analogous to East Lothian, an area where some people would think is prosperous, but has significant pockets of deprivation, and they've successfully navigated the process. It's also the case that every local authority in Scotland received £125,000 in capacity funding to help with bidding. So irrespective of size, that money was allocated to, you know, everyone from Highland to Clackmannanshire. So again, I think it's perfectly legitimate to say that in the allocation process, a slightly different weighting might have meant to some people a slightly more effectively targeted allocation of funds, but we believe that the approach that we've taken balances deprivation overall with the ability of the council to deliver, and also there is a specific alteration that we made to the way in which the Levelling Up Fund is allocated to take account of Scotland's needs. So one thing that is specific to Scotland and not other parts of the UK when it comes to allocating Levelling Up Funds is dwelling vacancy rates, in effect depopulation. Because as we know, the population of Scotland, and like the population of the rest of the UK, has generally moved from west to east in terms of growth over the course of the last few years. And so that's why Lough projects take account of that depopulation factor, and dwelling vacancy rates was agreed to be the best proxy for that factor.
Yeah, I mean, the Western Isles is one of the most deprived areas of Scotland and the most rural, and it's suffered depopulation and it hasn't received any funding, for example. So that's an issue. I mean, one of the things I think as well that's come up is the fact that because, well, I'll just quote what the National Audit Office is saying. They're basically saying that the three funds, UK Prosperity Fund, Levelling Up Fund, Towns Fund, have overlapping objectives and were designed and announced at different times, such that local authorities couldn't align their plans. And they seem to be indicating that within the UK government itself, perhaps departments weren't speaking to each other the way they should, so that you had a more kind of complete, rounded picture, just so that resources are allocated much more effectively and efficiently. Do you think that's something that's there's some truth in that? I mean,
I don't think so. No, I mean, again, different people will interpret the purpose of these funds in different ways. But I do think that they all serve specific and yes, sometimes overlapping purposes, but that can be a good thing. So, to take, obviously, a city I know well, Aberdeen, it was successful in the first round of Levelling Up funding. That money, £20 million, is going to a significant new city centre project, which is transforming the old market area just behind Union Street. And that is complementary to the work that's being done in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire through the investment zone funding, which in turn is complementary to the work that is being done through the energy transition zone. They're all examples of working together there. And you mentioned the Western Isles, and it's true that the Western Isles was not an early recipient of Levelling Up funding. However, the Western Isles is now, with the UK government and the Scottish government, in a Levelling Up partnership, which means £20 million going to the Western Isles Council. In addition, there are a number of specific projects that we've backed in the Western Isles. Money has gone to from the Shared Prosperity Fund to Macaulay College, which is a fantastic initiative that helps young people in the Western Isles. And these are all examples of our efforts to ensure that the Western Isles, because of the challenges you quite rightly point out, are prioritised for targeted funding. More broadly, the Western Isles, and for that matter, Argyll and Bute and Orkney and Shetland councils, play a big part in our Islands Forum, which is a UK-wide body which the Welsh Government, the Scottish Government, the Northern Ireland Executive and the UK Government have set up together to deal with specific needs of Ireland's communities. And at the moment, there is a shared task and finish group that we're working together to look at connectivity, not just the issue of ferries, but also digital connectivity between the islands and the mainland of Great Britain.
OK, thank you very much. I'm going to open up this session to colleagues around the table now, and the first to ask questions will be Liz, to be followed by John.
Good morning, Secretary of State. When you were last at committee back in February 2022, three members of the committee, myself, Michelle Thompson and Daniel Johnson at the time, asked you a little bit about the objective analysis that goes into the decision-making process as to who gets money and who doesn't.
Yes.
And you said on that occasion, you said, and I quote, you're absolutely confident that the assessment is objective, but you would come back to the committee to explain if we have any concerns about that objectivity and whether people understand the process by which awards are made. And since that time, I'm very pleased to hear not only have we had very complimentary comments about the process from, in the, certainly the last year, we had 13 out of the local authorities saying that they were very pleased with this, but obviously there are some local authorities who have not been successful.
Yes.
And they are slightly critical about the fact that they are not aware with sufficient transparency about who gets what and who doesn't. Could you update us on where we are with that?
Yes, of course. And thank you, Liz. So when it comes to the Levelling Up Fund and the allocation of money, we identified priority areas. And there are three principal metrics that we use initially. The first is productivity, and that's GVA per hour. The second is the unemployment rate amongst those over the age of 16. And the third is skills. And we measure the proportion of the 16 to 64 population without the NVQ or equivalent qualifications. Obviously, different qualifications in Scotland and England, but we use those as the first set of metrics. Then, as I mentioned, in Scotland in particular, sorry about the light, I think they're changing it here. In Scotland in particular, we have the dwelling vacancy rate, the depopulation, the rurality measure. So all of those are the principal metrics. And then once that we've identified areas, it's then the case that we look at a scoring for skills, pay, productivity and health. And then we allocate scores to different areas. And for the most recent Levelling Up Fund, for all of those places that we'd identified as priority places, against that this scoring mechanism, anywhere across the UK that scored above 74.25 got money. In Scotland, the threshold was slightly lower at 72.25. There are slightly different methods of allocation for the long-term plan for towns. For Levelling Up Partnerships, i.e. the money that's going to the Western Isles, the Borders, Dundee, and also Argyll and Bute, we worked with the Scottish Government to have a shared methodology, and that's a composite methodology which incorporates both some of the metrics I've mentioned in terms of levelling up need, and then some information from the Scottish Government that again related to access to services and depopulation. So the process is transparent. Of course, there are some local authorities which haven't yet received funding, Angus, Perth and Kinross, which I understand are disappointed. But what we want to do is to work with them, because there are other ways in which we can support them. And again, to take a case in point, Dundee understandably was disappointed not to receive an investment zone or a green free port. But the objective metrics that we used meant that we could enter into a levelling up partnership with Dundee. And I have to say that the leader of Dundee Council, obviously an SNP leader, John Alexander, while he was initially disappointed, has been a very constructive partner in making the case for UK government investment in Dundee.
Thank you. That's a very helpful update. Would it be your view that in the intervening period between your previous attendance at this committee 2 years ago, there are now better relationships between the UK government and the Scottish government in terms of assessing what these criteria are?
I believe so. And I believe that's been influenced by the work of the committee and also our engagement with COSLA at a corporate level and individual leaders at local government level.
Okay. When it comes to those local authorities which are disappointed and obviously not been successful, is there a process by which they can be fully aware, A, of where the criteria was not met for them and why their bid failed? I mean, do they understand why it is exactly why their bid wasn't successful?
I would hope so, yes. And again, it will sometimes be the case that... you know, bids will also be assessed on the basis of deliverability, and some people might think that we're taking a more critical view of their capacity to deliver than is actually the case. But we have a team of UK government civil servants based in Scotland, led by a wonderful civil servant called Lauren Bruce, who will work with any local authority in order to make sure, or indeed any institution, in order to make sure that they understand the bidding process. So obviously there are some bids, this is a smaller pot, in the Community Ownership Fund, which will be put forward by individual institutions and communities below local government level. And Lauren and her team also work with those. And there have been some successful bids in Perth and Kinross and in Angus from communities. So even though the local authority may not have received the money, the community has. So the Rannoch Hub in Perth and Kinross received money, I think something like £250,000, because of a successful community-led bid.
Again, that's very helpful. Just one further point, if I may. Another question we had at the time was about the data that was being used to underpin the criteria that you've just spoken about, whether that's productivity, unemployment, rurality, etc. And we were a little concerned 2 years ago about the fact that some of the interpretation of that, which came largely from the Office of National Statistics, was maybe not quite the same data that was being used when it comes to assessing what's happening in the Scottish economy. Has that problem been ironed out?
I hope so. We have a concordat which the UK government and the Scottish government have on the use of ONS data. And my understanding is that even though there may be different interpretations of it, there's a sort of shared database or shared base of data. But one of the things that I'm very, very keen to do is to make sure that just as the committee needs the best possible data to scrutinise the performance of the Scottish Government, that the Scottish Government and you get access to our data as well. And if the committee feels that there is, for any reason, a better or fairer interpretation of data by the Scottish Government than by the UK Government, then we will take that into account.
Again, that's helpful because I think it's very important that we do have the ability to scrutinise whether the money that is being awarded is obviously being spent in the right place and whether it's seen to be on an objective and fair basis. So thank you very much, Secretary of State.
Thank you, John. To be followed by Michael.
Hey, thanks very much, Convener. Mr Gove, the whole term levelling up suggests to me that people, areas or people who are poorer or who are further down the scale or however it's described should be pulled up nearer the people at the top. So that's a real emphasis on need. And yet there seems to be, and in some of the answers you've already given to Ms Smith and others, the idea of a geographic spread of the money that's going out. And I just wonder if these two are compatible. You know, some people would have expected all the money to go to really needy areas and none to go to Aberdeenshire, despite the fact Aberdeenshire might have some pockets of deprivation. How do you square these?
Well, I think, in a way, you put the case very fairly. So, we allocate the money against objective criteria. And as you quite rightly say, the nature of need varies according to geography, as well as economic factors. One of the points that was very well made, I think, by committee members the last time I appeared was the way in which EU funding recognised this in the past. Hence, the significant share of EU funding that went to the Highlands and Islands because of the particular challenges, productivity and connectivity challenges, that communities there face. But what I would argue is that we've seen, particularly, for example, through the long-term partnership for towns, and particularly through the towns with which we've been working, a recognition that, as I say, you know, Clydebank, Coatbridge, Greenock, Irvine, Kilmarnock, these are all communities, I think we would all agree, with enormous talent and potential there, but which haven't always benefited from the broader economic growth that the UK, I should say, as a whole, has enjoyed. So we do seek to make sure that funding goes to areas where productivity has been lower in the past and there's a chance for productivity to improve, but we also recognise that by its very nature, Scotland, like the whole of the UK, has diverse communities that we need to stitch into this broader pattern of growth and prosperity.
And is it too early to say if any of this has been successful? I mean, I realise that some of the money is a lot of the money is still to be spent.
Yes.
When will we be able to make a judgment as to whether UK has been levelled up and some of these communities have been levelled up?
Well, in our levelling up white paper, we set out a series of missions, and they're UK-wide. They depend upon partnership, obviously, to succeed. Some in the Scottish Government have criticised the establishment of those missions, but we feel that as a UK government, we have a responsibility to set out our ambition for the whole UK. And I think it's a legitimate area of political debate as to whether or not we've set the right missions. But we are holding ourselves to account on everything from educational improvement through to improved public health, through to improving productivity. And we are explicitly saying that when it comes to, for example, research and development money, that we need to show that we're improving the way in which research and development money from both the public and the private sector is allocated outside London and the South East. And then, as I say, when it comes to things like public health, we want to ensure that we close the gap between the poorer and the wealthier areas of the country in a number of metrics. I think most people would agree that the missions that we've set are quite challenging, and we're very happy to be held to account for them. But on a day-to-day basis, one of the other things will be delivery. And as I mentioned earlier, the choice of the Inverness and Cromarty Freeport, Green Freeport, was driven by a recognition that there have been various efforts to ensure an industrial presence in that part of the Highlands over the years, some of which have been more successful than others. This is our commitment to making sure that the skilled workers in that part of Scotland have an industrial future. And as I say, the good news reported in the P&J today suggests that that at least is moving in the right direction.
Yeah, I just wonder if the amounts of money are going to make that kind of significant difference. I mean, Glasgow is not the biggest city in the UK, but it's fairly large. Yeah. You know, we got £13 million to upgrade a set of dilapidated stables in quite a wealthy part of the city, it has to be said. And the £15 million from Drumchapel is very welcome. But, I mean, the £28 million, you've already mentioned the investment zone as well. But, I mean, these are only scratching the surface in Glasgow. I mean, would the amounts not need to be a lot higher to make a real impact?
Well, I think, again, it's important to see things in context. So it's also the case that the UK Share Prosperity Fund is giving £22 million to Glasgow. And it's also the case that we have committed, alongside the investment zone, to, for example, some specific investment in innovation. So something called the STAC, the Smart Things Accelerator Centre, is an investment that we've made in Glasgow alongside the investment zone in order to try to stimulate growth. I take your point about the Pollock Stables, but it was a bid that was put forward by Glasgow City Council, backed by the leader of Glasgow City Council, and what it will contribute to is making the already existing ecosystem around the Burrell collection and so on even more attractive for tourism. It also contributes to an educational offer. And while that area itself is relatively prosperous, as you know, it's surrounded by, or rather adjacent to, significant areas of deprivation in Glasgow as well.
OK, thanks so much for that. You've already mentioned a number of times the long-term plan for towns and the seven towns that were chosen. Can you say a little more about how the seven towns were chosen?
Yes, again, we have a set of criteria. So we rank local authorities by levelling up need, and that was alongside the metrics, or using the metrics in the levelling up white paper. So there, the metrics included pay, productivity, skills and health, as I mentioned before. We also looked at population size and levels of deprivation. And then we excluded local authorities without built-up areas which were within the population threshold for towns, which is about 20,000 to 100,000. I mean, one can always argue for, you know, a greater degree of flex, but we felt this was the right way of defining a town. And then the most deprived built-up area within each of the local authorities identified was then selected using the index of multiple deprivation. And we used the specific Scottish index of multiple deprivation, which I think is derived in a slightly different way from the IMD in England. We then had a cap of no more than three local authorities for each particular region, the top seven eligible local authorities were selected. So that's Clydebanken, as I say, in Western Bartonshire, Coatbridge in North Lanarkshire, Dumfries and Dumfries and Galloway, Elgin and Moray, Greenock, and then Irvine and Kilmarnock. And Irvine's in North Ayrshire, Kilmarnock's in East Ayrshire.
OK, thanks for that. I mean, it does all just seem very complex. I mean, clearly you've got staff and councils and the Scottish Government all have staff doing quite a lot of work on this. Yes. Either you've been analysing the figures or the councils have been putting in bids and in the competitive process and so on. Do you think, in retrospect, that having so many funds with so many factors involved has been the best way of allocating the money? I mean, you could just have said, right, well, based on SIMD or something like that, we'll just give, we'll top up the housing budget right across the UK, and that would have been pretty welcome in most council areas, and it would have saved all the analysis and all the applications. Would that not have been a better method?
Well, here, the work, for the most part, has been done by the UK government, with statistics and support from the Scottish government. But I think that it's in the nature of levelling up and in the nature of public policy that you need to use different tools in order to help different areas. So there will be some parts of the country where there's already, a mix of talent and skills. An additional intervention can catalyse that into economic growth. There'll be other areas with connectivity issues where that is the intervention that will be required in order to level up. And again, you know, when, for example, Fiona Robson is thinking about allocating money within the Scottish Government's budget, there will be some quite complex trade-offs that she and her team will have to undertake. But she's doing that in order to make sure that she can get the right tax mix as she sees it and get the right spending interventions as she and the First Minister see them. So, yes, there is sometimes work for local authorities to do in some of the bidding process, but most of the work, most of the assessment work is done by UK government. And the work that local government is doing is, in a way, a sort of testing of their ability to deliver some of these projects. Without wanting to put words into people's mouths, while many in local government would prefer a straightforward allocation process, they also recognise some of the benefits of a competitive process alongside that as well.
OK, can I just have one other area I want to touch on? With some of the councils we spoke to were talking about need for more flexibility, either on timescales. East Lothian, for example, talked about it would be good to have a five-year funding model so that they could really plan ahead. And Renfrewshire and Aberdeenshire both said that, for example, the money for numeracy wasn't really a priority for them. They would have liked to have used it maybe for literacy or something else. Is there enough flexibility in the schemes?
I think that's a fair challenge. I mean, I think that the first thing is that I would very much like to have a longer-term approach throughout, and that's one of the things that we're discussing in terms of the the current spending review. I mean, again, the settlement in the Scottish Government's budget, in Shona Robertson's budget, is also a one-year settlement. For reasons I well understand, it's not a criticism, just an observation. So I'm sure she, like me, would prefer to be in a position where we could have a longer-term framework, and we do want to work with local authorities to achieve that. I should say that the long-term plan for towns explicitly creates a longer framework, a 10-year framework, and that's, you know, the sort of direction of travel I'd love to be in, that, that people would have certainty about their relationship with the UK government over that longer term period. On the other point about learning, your second point, again, I think that you know, the we're always open to the need for a greater degree of recognition of the lived experience of local authorities, yes.
OK, thank you.
OK, thank you. Michael, to follow by Ross.
Good morning, Secretary of State. You've set out some detail already in terms of the application processes and assessment criteria around Levelling Up Fund, Community Ownership Fund, the long-term plan for towns. So welcome to hear much of that. But why did the process on investment zones in Scotland diverge so significantly from all of those other areas?
Well, we developed a joint methodology with the Scottish Government. And investment zones as a principle. Firstly, there have been enterprise zones in the past. Enterprise zones were created and were the brainchild of Michael Heseltine. And then there were enterprise zones that were also created at the beginning of the coalition government. During the brief period when Liz Truss was Prime Minister, she thought about the investment zones being spread very far and wide across the UK and then being driven primarily by deregulation. Once Jeremy Hunt became Chancellor and Rishi Sunak became Prime Minister, what we wanted to do was to have a more targeted approach built around areas of research excellence. And we wanted to make sure that we could align those in Scotland with Scotland's regional economic partnerships. And so that is why we developed a shared approach, firstly with Kate Forbes and then with her successors, in order to identify appropriate areas.
So in England, there was an invitation to application that was published on the 2nd of October 2022, and that included guidance for the expression of interest, and those investment zones were announced in the budget on the 15th of March 2023. Yes. In Scotland, there was no bidding or invitation process at all. Neil Gray answered a PQ to me back in July of last year, saying the invitation to host an investment zone was not subject to a bidding or application process. Again, why the divergence?
Indeed, partly because local authorities in Scotland said that they didn't want to go through a bidding process. You know, again, one of the points that's been made by some local authorities is that the process of bidding can be resource intensive, and that if you put together a bid in a particular way, and this was reflected after some of the, you know, the learning from the Green Freeport process, that it can be it can consume scarce resource. I myself believe that a competitive process can often be a very useful way of testing the ability of local government to deliver.
On that point, you say that local authorities didn't want a competitive. I mean, that's...
Yes.
Were local authorities all asked? We have 32 of them in Scotland, where they were asked and said, do you want to bid for this? And you don't want, because I've FOI'd all correspondence on this. I don't see any evidence that local authorities were asked whether they wanted to have a bidding process or to have an investment zone.
Well, the first thing is, my understanding is that local authorities in Scotland said that when it came to this process, they would prefer not to have a bidding process. It's certainly the case that we wanted to deliver it in partnership with the Scottish Government. And what we agreed with the Scottish Government is that we would score each of Scotland's regional economic partnerships against their economic and innovation potential, their well-being economy need, and the strength of the knowledge anchors and also other sectoral strengths. And on that basis, we came to an agreed solution. One of the things that, again, I would stress is that wherever possible, with all of our levelling up interventions, we've wanted to work with the Scottish Government in order to find a way of allocating resource appropriately.
So do you not think it was not even suboptimal, but really unacceptable that the selection criteria and the process was only published retrospectively, 7 weeks after the decision was actually announced? Like, again, that's in stark contrast to what happened in the English process.
I don't think so, no, because, I think what we wanted to do was to make sure that we delivered investment zones relatively speedily, and the choice of investment zones complements the other interventions that we've made elsewhere. And again, the process, from my point of view, is to seek partnership with the Scottish Government wherever possible, and to accommodate ourselves to the Scottish Government's priorities as well, which is why, you know, theoretically, the UK Government could say, we're going to create and direct investment zones in this area or that area, with that geography or this geography. The Scottish Government has made its own decisions about the economic geography of regional economic partnerships, and so we work with that. Again, to sort of editorialise slightly, the argument is sometimes made that the UK government, you know, careers around like some sort of economic Excel bully dog, deciding what it will do in Scotland willy-nilly. In fact, the reality is partnership with the Scottish government.
Okay. You stressed the issue of transparency. I'm a bit disappointed that you don't think it's unacceptable for the process to be published ahead of time. But let me join into probably the speculation around this and a lot of the coverage that came at the time. Mm. So the allocation investment zones were in Glasgow, where the SNP are defending seats in the general election, and in Aberdeenshire, where the Conservatives are defending seats in the general election. Do you not understand that in the absence of a published criteria and a process ahead of time, you open up both of your parties, the Conservatives and the SNP, to accusations of the kind I'm just making?
We're everywhere.
Well, of course, all sorts of allegations are sometimes flung, but the fact that the criteria were published means that people can judge the basis on which the allocation was made. But I would also say that the allocation of funds to, I never want to rule out Conservative electoral prospects anywhere, but we're allocating funds, as I said, to Clydebank, Coatbridge, Greenock, Irvine and Kilmarnock. And I don't think they're yet on our target list for the next general election, though, you know, hope springs eternal. So I quite understand folks will speculate about political motivation behind this, but overall, if you look at the spread of investment and some of the areas that we're investing in, then there's no electoral benefit for the Conservative Party. What there is a benefit for the communities concerned and the whole United Kingdom.
But you do understand my, I suppose, the frustration. You've mentioned the case of Dundee already, and as a native Dundonian from that city, I represent the whole of the North East, and I'm very welcoming of investment in Aberdeenshire and Aberdeen. Mm. But we have in Dundee particular economic need, which you've already set out. Yes. We have the finest life sciences university in the whole of the UK, top in the ref for the last 14 years, absolutely outstanding and well ahead of any other part of institutions in Scotland and parts of the rest of the UK. And so there's real consternation at that point in the absence of a published criteria and real local anger. And if you saw the press clippings at that time, Secretary of State, you would have understood that. The local paper in the Courier, an absolute uproar, the fact that we had not received a green free port, we had not received an investment zone. So would you say that from now on you want to see in these joint enterprises between yourselves and the Scottish Government a bidding criteria set out ahead of time so that local authorities can then put themselves and build the right criteria, can make the right case and make the argument that I've just made as to the particular need of a geography?
Well, I'd say two things. I think the criteria was set out and people can judge objectively whether or not the right decision was made on investment zones according to that criteria, or those criteria. Secondly, the levelling up partnerships were chosen not through a competitive process, but through an allocative process, again, with criteria agreed with the Scottish Government and then subsequently laid out. And all of the levelling up partnerships that we set up, one of them was, of course, with Dundee. The third thing that I would say is that there has been UK government investment in Dundee, obviously and most conspicuously and most brilliantly, through the V&A. But it is also the case, you're right, that Dundee University and the James Hutton Institute are outstanding higher education institutions, as is Abertay University. So Dundee has a lot going for it. And the levelling up partnership that we've set up with Dundee, I think, was welcomed by the leader of Dundee Council. Of course, there'd been some upset beforehand, but I remember not just the front page of the Courier being disappointed that it didn't get an investment zone. I remember the front page of the P&J when Aberdeen missed out on being a green freeport. And at the time, the accusation was made that the government's approach towards Aberdeen was ABBA. Anywhere but bloody Aberdeen. So again, at different points, different civic leaders have expressed their desire to make sure that they benefit from UK government funding. And naturally, when location A wins out over location B, there is a sense of disappointment. But the broader point I would make is the levelling up programme has resulted in stronger relationships between the UK government and the Scottish government, stronger relationships between the UK government and local government in Scotland, and stronger relationships between the UK government and civil society and business. There was some scepticism about our embarking on this route and using the financial assistance power a few years ago, but now it's become part of the sort of architecture of the United Kingdom. And in a way, while I can understand and share the frustration that various different people have had at different times about not winning out, overall, I think, whatever the particular concerns that people have over the process, the act of the UK government supporting local government in Scotland, I think, has been widely welcomed.
Yeah, I remain sceptical, I have to say, Mr Gove, that on the 14th of September, Neil Gray told Parliament that the process for the selection and the decision for the investments were agreed on the same date of the 22nd of June. So I remain sceptical about the process. Can I close, though, push the convener's indulgence, on the spending? We're talking about allocations here, but there are not real challenges in actually getting the money spent in local authorities, and do we not risk replicating the city deal process, which, you know, applications went in for now over a decade ago, and that actually many of those projects across Scotland have not materialised because that money has not actually been spent in communities? Are you concerned about spend versus allocation?
Yes, and we do want to make sure that money, once having been allocated, does hit the sides, as it were, and does make a real contribution. And that's why in one recent visit that I made to Aberdeen, I was so pleased to see that the work, as you will have seen, going on just behind Union Street is proceeding, that both the demolition and the construction work is proceeding there in the first round of levelling up funding in order to help enhance the city centre. So that work is going on. And again, when I visited the Cromarty Freeport, I was very, very excited to see the investment that was going in there and the changes that were occurring on the ground. Ditto when I visited the Pollock Stables and Sawmill. So absolutely, and we will work with local government in Scotland and the Scottish Government to make sure that that cash translates into action.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ross, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. Morning, Secretary of State. I'd like to follow up John's line of questioning around the length of funding, but just before that, I note that yesterday the Welsh Government published the report from the Independent Commission on the Constitutional Future of Wales, and it included some really interesting research on public opinion across the UK, including specifically on when and if the UK government should spend in devolved areas. And only 5% of people in Scotland thought it should do so whenever it wants, and 18% thought not normally and without consent, but there may be circumstances in which it should. That's actually less than the percentage of people who thought that UK government should legislate in devolved areas, which was also quite low. Regards to the fact that people welcome when funding comes to their area and many of the projects have merit, are you not concerned about the core democratic point here, that people in Scotland, I have to say that the findings in Scotland are not particularly different to England or Wales in this regard, but that people don't believe the UK government should be spending directly in devolved areas. They seem to prefer, if the money was given to the Scottish government or directly to the local authorities, for them to then decide how they spend it.
Well, I think two things. The first is that, as we mentioned earlier, the Scottish Government has £41 billion in a block grant to spend as it believes is appropriate. In comparison to that, while I believe that the amount of money that the UK government is spending is significant and welcome and has been appreciated by folk in local government, the overwhelming majority of public spending in Scotland, if you exclude, obviously, welfare and defence and so on in those reserved areas, the overwhelming majority is within the control of the Scottish Government and within the scrutiny of the Scottish Parliament. And so the performance of the public services that so many people rely on, the NHS in Scotland, the delivery of justice and crime, education, the money there is within the hands of the Scottish Government and spent by the Scottish Government. I would love to be able to help and support the Scottish Government in the area, for example, of education. But we respect the devolution settlement and respect the policy setting and spending should be there. But if we're thinking about the economic development of the UK overall, then if we have a partnership with local government and with the Scottish Government, then I think that is a partnership for good. We share an island, we share a currency, we share institutions. And therefore, if we're thinking about, as I say, the wonderful Green Freeport in the Highlands or the Firth of Forth. These are projects where the UK government can use its leverage alongside the Scottish government and alongside local government to make a difference. And it's never the case that we impose spending. We always have willing partners. When Kate Forbes was finance secretary, she did a brilliant job in making sure that the Scottish Government's interests were represented in the design of the Green Freeport process.
It is a partnership. It's not a partnership of equals, though, because ultimately it's your money and you decide how it's spent. And whether it's 100 quid or 100 billion quid that you're spending in Scotland, the core point here, and that I'd be interested in your thoughts on, is the vast majority of people in Scotland don't think you should be the ones doing that if the spending is in a devolved area. If it's in a reserved area, totally different. But the core point here is a lot of this money is going into spending in devolved areas, whether or not the individual projects are welcome. The vast majority of people don't believe the UK government should be making those decisions. They would prefer you gave that money to the institutions that people in Scotland have decided should make those decisions, either the Scottish Parliament and government or the local authorities themselves. Why do you think that only a very, very small minority of people in Scotland believe the UK government should spend in devolved areas?
Well, the independent commission on the Constitution for Wales, very distinguished group of people, but it is one poll. And I think that if you ask the question in a different way, if you said, do you believe that the UK government should work with the Scottish government and local authorities in order to increase prosperity, and that the UK government should use some of its own money to help some of the most deprived communities in Scotland to achieve more, then I think people would say, yes, absolutely.
Moving on, because I'm conscious of time, going back to the points that John Mason was raising around the length of the funding, I know that you compared it to the Scottish Government's annual budget, and I would point out, you mentioned sympathy for the Finance Secretary and the fact that it's only annual. I would point out it's annual because your government gives the Scottish Government an annual settlement. Your government has the power to give multi-year settlements. And if you want to advocate for that around the Cabinet table, I think you'd find cross-party support for you doing so. But point in relation to this that was highlighted by some of the local authorities gave us evidence is that the three-year funding model for the Shared Prosperity Fund compares pretty poorly to the seven-year funding model for EU structural funds, particularly when they were highlighting that the delays to releasing the funds meant effectively for a lot of these projects there's been a two-year dash to deliver, funding only being released at the end of December 2022, so you've only got one quarter of that financial year left in which to spend it, so you've essentially got a two-year dash to spend. Do you recognise the concerns there, that particularly for multi-year capital projects, 2 years is a very short window of time, or 2.25 years in the case of the evidence that we were got. That's a very narrow period of time, and it may not result in best value for money because there is that push to just get the money out the door before the deadline.
Yes, no, I do recognise that. And obviously we recognise that there are some projects which are long-term, as I mentioned earlier. Our allocation of funding to towns is part of a long-term plan for towns, over 10 years, helping to create a sense of buy-in, of community ownership of how that money is spent. If we can move increasingly to that model, then that would be great. That is exactly the direction of travel that we want to undertake. But I operate, forgive me, within the spending review envelopes that we have. One of the things I would say about EU funding is that EU funding often didn't or wasn't shaped by communities in the way that our funds have been. We believe very strongly in devolution in its fullest sense, in making sure that not just that the Scottish Government is a partner and not just Scottish local authorities are a partner, but individual communities are partners as well. And that's what the long-term plan for towns is about. It's also what the Community Ownership Fund is about.
Why a three-year funding period in that case? Why not 5 or 7 or 10?
Well, I think, again, where we can enter into partnerships, which are longer term, as I say, the long-term plan for towns does just that, we will. But the spending review process has generally operated on a sort of three-year cycle, for the UK government and for other governments. If we can embed a greater degree of certainty of funding, then that's great. I should add that both with investment zones and with green free ports, the tax and other benefits that had been put in place for just 5 years are now in place for 10 years as well. Now, obviously, a future government, a future UK government, could change that. But my sense is that the initial scepticism that some had towards the idea of green free ports has been dissipated by the fact that what we've seen has been significant investment in renewables and in green energy. And as I say, when I visited the Cromarty Freeport, it was fantastic to see that Scotland retained its cutting-edge position as a renewables superpower as a result of a combined Scottish Government and UK Government investment.
Some of us still retain significant concern about the Freeports, but that's a separate debate. Just finally, though, just briefly, Secretary of State, have you ever raised concerns with any of the chancellors that you've worked with Treasury officials, that the spending review periods are resulting in the UK government not getting best value for money, that it's limiting the options that you have in your portfolio to develop multi-year funding models that would actually provide better value for money as well as greater certainty?
One thing I've learned is that if you want to get something out of a finance minister, you don't discuss publicly the conversations you've had with them.
Having also engaged in budget negotiations, I can sympathise with that point at least. Thank you. That's Convener.
Thank you. Jamie, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Secretary of State. I just wanted to ask a number of areas, particularly relative to kind of projects which are underway at the moment. As of the 31st of March last year, 404 projects were funded under round 1 and 2. 10 had not started, 333 were underway, 5 had been completed, and 51 were expected to be completed by the end of March this year. I'm just wondering how you measure the ongoing progress of these schemes, and also how that progress compares perhaps to previous EU schemes, because obviously it reflects on the processes that were involved in the applications, etc., and on kind of ongoing monitoring?
Yes, we do have a programme of monitoring and evaluation. And again, it's also the case that the National Audit Office and other UK-wide bodies look at how effective our delivery has been. I haven't drawn any direct comparisons about the speed or effectiveness of delivery of our programme with EU programmes, but I think it would be something that would be very welcome. I think that one of the strengths of devolution is that we can learn from different parts of the United Kingdom how effective partnership working has been in each of those parts of the United Kingdom, and then learn from each other. So, it is the case, I think, that we will be able, as we look at how all of these projects have been delivered, to identify local authorities in Scotland, for example, that have been much more effective in the operational delivery of capital investment than some local authorities in England. And I would want to be able to say to my counterparts in England, let's look at what's happened. Let's look at the way in which Shetland or Orkney or Aberdeenshire or Dundee have delivered. Let's learn from that.
So that will be part of a kind of appraisal process,
Exactly.
Looking forward to it. Yeah. Okay. Just because I'm conscious of time, I'll kind of move on. One of the areas, and I think it was raised by John Mason, was around flexibility of the processes. I'm kind of interested in the flexibility of the cash, and I think this probably refers more to the city-region deals and others. So, for example, and I know it's a subject you're aware of, the Corran Narrows ferry crossing.
Yes.
Recently, the government announced that some of the funding, the UK government announced some of the funding, around £20 million, which was part of the Inverness and Highland City regional deal, could be used for infrastructure
yes.
for that crossing, which is vitally important. That was welcomed by the local council, Highland Council, but the local community were more... there were many in the local community who were more interested in a replacement ferry. Now, there'd already been that flexibility in use of the cash from yes. the UK government. How much additional flexibility is there in those sorts of schemes? And obviously that's a question of working, I appreciate, with partners.
Yes. I want to give the maximum amount of flexibility. As I think you know, I talked to Highland Council about this. I know that the problems with the ferry are adding more than an hour, at least, to travelling times for people in that part of the Highlands. We know it would require significant capital investment, but we do want to look to see what can be done. It's always the case that if you give some local authorities additional flexibility above and beyond that which other local authorities have enjoyed, some might say, hey, this money came with some strings attached. We understand that. Now you're releasing or providing a greater degree of flexibility between revenue and capital or whatever for this local authority. But I think, as you quite rightly point out, each case is a specific case. And here we have communities in effect which have been, reliant on a particular piece of infrastructure. When that infrastructure has been faulty, then the daily lives of hundreds, thousands of people have been disrupted. And therefore, we want to work with Highland Council to try and address that.
I suppose with this and with any other kind of examples, it's a balance of not eroding the original kind of objectives and targets of,
exactly.
of the original funding. Yeah, and just really to finish, you've highlighted obviously the issues around islands and island groups. I'm from Orkney, and I'm very aware as well, of course, the importance of the Fair Isle ferry funding as part of the Levelling Up Fund. It was determined that it was said by the by Shetland Council that essentially saved. Fair Isle as an inhabited, populated island.
Yes.
You've talked about the Islands Forum group and the new group that will be looking at islands connectivity and particularly around transport. I'm wondering if you can kind of give us an update on when you hope there to be further, further updates or further progress on that.
Yes, there should be a meeting of the Islands Forum in Anglesey. In a couple of months, 6 weeks to a couple of months' time, and I hope that we'll be able to update then. But thank you for mentioning the leadership shown by Shetland Council. As you say, if it hadn't been for Shetland Council's leadership and for the commitment that we were able to make through the Levelling Up Fund, then the very future of Fair Isle as a populated island would have been under threat, and that would have been, to my mind, a terrible outcome for the for the Shetlands, for Scotland overall. The issue of ferries, as the committee knows, is a particularly challenging one. Investment in ferries a generation ago means that we now have, across Scotland, across the islands, a need for new investment in ferries. Orkney in particular, intra-Orkney ferries require attention, and we've been talking to Orkney Council about that. And, of course, the whole CalMac fleet. Again, you know, as the committee knows, the Scottish Government has had its challenges in this area. What we wanted to do was to use our resource and our analytical ability to look at connectivity overall and to see what more could be done in order to ensure that those island communities get the connectivity that they deserve. And I believe that the UK Government has been able to bring to bear an additional level of support to those communities whose economic interests matter so much.
That's why welcome. I'm sure that will be well received in the islands. Thanks very much, Secretary of State.
Thank you. Michelle?
Good morning, Mr Gove. Thanks for joining us today. Isn't the real reason that the money for all these funds cannot match UK EU funding is because UK's trading broke, debt to GDP ratio is nearly at parity, and the cost of servicing UK debt interest is £318 million a day? Isn't that the real reason that the UK's trading broke?
I don't think so. My understanding is that the percentage of UK trade with the EU since we left the EU has...
In using the term trading broke, I'm referring back to debt to GDP ratio. Mm. Debt is 98% of GDP, UK GDP.
Oh, yes. So, moving on to debt, one of the reasons, again, as I think the committee well understands, why we have the level of debt that we do is because of the COVID pandemic, primarily. So we were, as a polity, the United Kingdom had one of the most generous levels of support for people during COVID. Furlough, COVID business interruption loans, and so on, meant that we were supporting business and civil society more generously than other countries. That inevitably created a cost. It's also the case, as the committee will know, that the impact of war in Ukraine and indeed instability in the Middle East has had an inflationary effect. I talked about the steps that we've taken to reduce inflation. But yes, if we hadn't had the pandemic and if there weren't a war in Ukraine, then it would certainly be the case that Scotland and England would have stronger economies.
Well, of course, that's not actually the case. UK has been in economic decline, and the figures quite start from 1980. In 1980, UK's GDP per capita was in line with or exceeded most advanced economies, but by 2019, the gap had, with the small advanced economies, increased to 38%. But that's by the by. What I want to ask you about today, because I'm quite aware of time, you've mentioned green free ports a number of times. In my constituency of Falkirk East, Grangemouth, and of course the important port, is located. Yes. And you may recall the last time you were in front of the committee, I asked you about the role and your accountability to audit Scotland, because one of the concerns expressed about freeports is the possibility of corruption. And of course, the regulatory environment is all managed by the UK government. Now, I'm just going to flip over so that I've got the record of what both of us said with that. I'm quoting what you said to me. You said, "I'm accountable to the UK Parliament to audit Scotland," and so on. And I then asked, what specific agreement have you made with Audit Scotland in that respect? You replied to say, "I'm waiting for Audit Scotland to make any suggestion to me about what it'd like to do." So my first question is, have Audit Scotland been in touch with you, or have you been in touch with Audit Scotland as to how these green free ports can be given oversight to avoid potential risks of corruption?
I haven't. Myself, I don't think, received anything from Audit Scotland, but one of the key things, one of the benefits of the union is that you've got the Scottish Government and the UK Government working together. So I think that both of us have an interest. Neil Gray and I have an interest in making sure that these free ports are successful and making sure that the money that is being spent and allocated is appropriately publicly accountable.
And it's for that reason I'm asking. You will, of course, be well aware of the issues with potential, rather, for corruption in Teesside. And I noted with interest your decision to exclude the National Audit Office in England to set up your own kind of investigation. And given that the National Crime Agency suggests that £262 billion each and every year is lost to UK GDP as a result of money laundering and corruption, you'll see my interest in a stated role and full inclusivity for the for our Audit Scotland, so that I can make sure that there's no hint of that in the Green Freeport in Grangemouth. So I ask again, given that Audit Scotland haven't been in touch with you, and I will pick it up with them, will you share any findings with Audit Scotland as to what, and if anything, has gone wrong with Teesside, with the Freeport there?
Yes, I think the committee knows that certain allegations have been made of criminality and other shop practice. That's why we set up an independent inquiry led by independent figures in local government of unimpeachable integrity who will be reporting on these allegations. And I wouldn't want to preempt that inquiry, but I'd say two things. One, I think it is fair to say that no one has contested the integrity or appropriateness of the individuals who are conducting that inquiry. The other thing that I would say is that you know, in both parts of the United Kingdom, so in England and in Scotland, I think that we should have an even more vigorous exercise of scrutiny on a shared basis of how money is spent and how performance of public bodies operates. So I am all for a maximum amount of transparency. You know, sunlight is the best disinfectant.
Mm. So, just for the record, there can be no possibility of you avoiding scrutiny by Audit Scotland of any potential risks associated with any green freeports in Scotland, and you won't seek to exclude them as you have done with the National Audit Office in England.
Well, I didn't seek to exclude the National Audit Office. I wanted to make
sure that they're not involved, are they? They've got a very limited role in the current inquiry, rather than it should be led by them. And certainly in Scotland, I would anticipate being led by, you know, if it came to pass. I appreciate this is hypothetical.
Yes, I think there are two things. I think the National Audit Office has a broader capacity for scrutiny of the actions of the UK government than Audit Scotland does of the Scottish government, I think. But, you know, that's a matter for the Scottish Government and for Audit Scotland, not for me. But the Teesside allegations are being investigated very rigorously by, as I say, figures of unimpeachable authority. One thing that one can't ignore is that there's an element of small-p politics here, large-p politics, actually. Allegations were made about the Teesside Freeport by some people who were critical of the mayor of the Tees Valley and, indeed, opposed to the Freeports themselves. For example, there were allegations made about dredging leading to crustacean deaths and so on. Subsequent investigation showed that that was all nonsense and that the crustacean deaths were due to factors entirely separate from that. So we both know that in politics, sometimes people will pick up a stake or an allegation in order to make a political point. But I'm as confident can be, but I don't want to preempt the inquiry, that Ben Houchen's doing a great job and that the Freeport in Teesside has been a success. I'm also confident that the Freeport from which your constituents benefit will go on to be a success, just as it will be in the Highlands as well.
Yeah. So just for the record, just before I leave it, because I know the convener wants to come back in, you will submit yourself to full scrutiny of Audit Scotland in terms of looking under the covers of what happens in any green Freeport in Scotland. Just simple yes or no is fine.
Absolutely, 100% yes.
Thank you very much. Convener.
Thank you. I want to mention Multiply because no one else has so far, so I thought I'd touch on that. He said, Secretary of State, you've talked a lot about partnership working, but South Ayrshire Council, they're a Conservative-led authority, and they've said that the allocation for Multiply, which accounted for over 17% of UK Shared Prosperity Fund resources, was ring-fenced. It's doubtful whether South Ayrshire Council would have determined such allocation if it had been given discretion on this matter. The programme could have been much more effective by aligning and combining with numeracy and literacy interventions. The multiply financial allocations fall an even pattern that it will be challenging to spend even one third of our multiply allocation. So surely, if there's a partnership working and not in position that you've talked about, then that situation with a Conservative authority wouldn't be happening, surely.
Well, I think you're right that South Ayrshire have expressed that concern. And I think one of the previous questions, I think, I can't remember if it was from Michael or from John, touched on the fact that Aberdeenshire and I think Renfrewshire had raised similar concerns. The overall purpose of Multiply, to deal with one of the big problems that we have across the United Kingdom, which is relatively poor adult numeracy within some communities, I think is a great national purpose, great national endeavour. However, we learn from doing. And I think that if it is the case that we can build up an evidence base to show that some of the levelling up funding that has been allocated through Multiply could be better allocated through other interventions, then we'll look at that, absolutely, because the aim of Multiply is to address some of the, and I'm not talking about the, you know, what's happening in our schools at the moment, I'm talking about the inherited issues that some have in terms of being fully confident, particularly in a world where numeracy becomes more and more important.
Yes, it is more important, but it seems odd that the UK government should even be involved in this Multiply initiative, given that education is absolutely, completely devolved. And I do think that has not been, you know, if we're honest, has not been brought in through partnership working. That says the UK government's decided that they're going to impose that on Scotland, and that's it. I mean, I don't think for a single minute that the Scottish Minister said, oh, that's a great idea. They would have been happy if you'd have allocated additional funding through the block grant, you know, which they could spend on education. But to just come in and to impose something which even Conservative authorities believe they can't actually, you know, fully utilise the resources allocated is clearly a concern.
Yeah, no, I see these fair points. All I would say are, one, that this is, it's not, as I mentioned, an intervention in schools, it's an intervention in skills, and there is a distinction there because it's directly related to both our broad levelling up objectives, but also economic growth and economic development. The second thing is, the point made by South Ayrshire and others is that it's been difficult to deliver all of the funding that's been given. That argument could be interpreted in different ways. One, a lack of flexibility. One, over-generosity in this area. We'll learn from that and try to develop a new approach.
I certainly don't think there's any accusations of over-generosity, but I don't think that would come from any source, but certainly flexibility.
But for this channel. But the final thing I would say, and if you'll forgive me, Convener, is that the debate about skills and education, of course, is a hot topic, and I've got strong views on it, and I don't want to labour them in this committee. But the one thing that I do want to do is to make sure that we can learn from each other, that Scotland and England, Wales and Northern Ireland can learn from each other in schools, skills and higher education, because, of course, in higher education, UKRI operates on a UK basis. And I do think, given the challenges that the United Kingdom faces and that the next generation faces, having a proper civilised conversation about what's working and what isn't working in our different jurisdictions in education is a good thing. So, as I say, it's not for me to decree quite the opposite, but it is, I think, in all our interests to have that conversation.
I have to say that unlike in England, as has been pointed out by academics on the cross-party group, which Michael and I are both members of, the cross-party group in life sciences, all the Scottish universities do work together in partnership, but the English ones
absolutely
don't. And I'm pretty sure they'd be willing to work cross-border, etc. Now, we do have to finish for noon, so we've only got a couple of minutes left, so I'm just going to say just one last thing before I wind up. And that's just a comment from Zoe Billingham, the director of the Institute of Public Policy Research think tank, who said that the National Audit Office on levelling up said, and I quote, this was a litany of missed deadlines, moving goalposts and dysfunction in the way levelling up funds have been allocated to councils as part of the government's flagship programme. And in Scotland, of course, we've also had the imposition of the Internal Market Act, which means it cuts across devolved policy. So just to give you the final word, Secretary of State, what will you do differently to ensure that going forward, levelling up is much more impactful and effective for those it's trying to assist?
Well, I think I look forward to this committee's recommendations and the feedback from local government. We've already improved the way in which we interact with local authorities through the project adjustment requests that I mentioned earlier, allowing people a greater degree of flexibility. We're learning that trying to, while still keeping a competitive element, having a more allocative approach in some of the projects helps. And we're also learning from work on the ground. One of the things I would say is that sometimes it's good practice on the ground that we can advertise and spread that will help overall. So we've just been touching on Multiply. In Perth and Kinross, they've been using Multiply funding to give support to young entrepreneurs because a lack of numeracy was apparently, or full numeracy, was the reason for business failure. So, you know, the success of Perth and Kinross in using Multiply funding is one way of spreading good practice, much as I might say the success so far of Aberdeen City Council in using its money for urban regeneration will help us to spread good practice elsewhere, and the success of Roy McGregor and the team behind the Cromarty Freeport will help us elsewhere. So, yes, the UK government has lessons to learn, but those lessons are best learned from practitioners on the ground in local government and in business.
Thank you very much for your time, Secretary of State. It's very much appreciated by members of this committee. And we do hope you'll come back to committee in the near future. We'd hope to see you in October 22, and it's been a long time since then. So if you can see us, particularly in person, that would certainly be wonderful, and we could go into some of these subjects in greater depth. The Parliament, the Scottish Parliament also has an important role to play in relation to scrutiny and transparency of this funding, and this committee looks forward to continue its work with you. Thank you very much.
No, thank you very much, Convener, and I hope to be in Holyrood soon.
Thank you. And I'll call this meeting now to a close. Thank you, everyone.